Good evening. We are October 28th. This is Google Rocks number 54. Hard to believe. One in front of the other, and here we are at 54. And today we have a special guest who we'll introduce in a second. We'll be talking about Schools of the Future Conference, which is happening June 6th and 7th and of November. Thank you. And
November 6th and 7th.
Which is next week. And so we'll talk about that. Our special guest is Phil Bossert, but we will get to him in a second. We'll go ahead and introduce the rest of our panelists. Holly, if you would begin.
Hi, I'm Holly Gates. I'm the librarian at Haiku Elementary School.
Okay, Michael.
Hey, everyone. I'm Mike Fricano. I am a tech integration specialist for Iolani School.
Michelle?
Hi, I'm Michelle Colt, and I'm the librarian at Halekula Elementary School.
Librarian of the Year?
Yes, School Librarian of the Year. Nationally. Yay, go. Go, Michelle, and go, Hawaii. Represent. It's awesome. Yeah, really cool. Okay, so we have Phil Bossert, who's kind of the boss of the Schools of the Future, even though he says he's not. And he's going to tell us Schools of the Future Conference, which is coming up. And he'll tell us all about it, and we'll ask him questions. So, Phil, if you could give us a little background about yourself first.
Okay. I started out as a long time ago as a philosophy professor and thought that was my career. But I worked for a while for Hawaiian Telephone Company, and then Charlie Taguchi at Department of Education asked me to come on and start the Office of Information and Technology Telecommunication Services at DOE back in the 1990s. And that's how I got introduced to the whole area of tech and telecommunications for education. And I've been pretty much in that ever since, in one form or another, private sector, public sector. I've worked for DBED and worked for High Tech Development Corporation. And I'm currently working for Hawaii Association of Independent Schools as the director of programs. And I have been there for 6 years. And I was hired by Robert Witt at HAIS back in 2008. And the Hawaii Community Foundation had decided to fund a 5-year program initiative called Hawaii Schools of the Future. And it was going to pick 15 or 20 schools to work with over 5 years to change their learning environments from sort of standard-based learning to project-based learning and performance-based assessment. And so they asked me to run that project for them. And Community Foundation selected 20 schools. And starting in 2009, we started working with those schools. And the first year we took all of them, we took teams of about 5 or 6 people from those 20 schools to High Tech High in San Diego and spent a week there inspiring everybody, and then came back to Hawaii. And basically the Schools of the Future project involved coming together once a quarter with all of those schools to see how they were doing, what was working and what was not. They got money for professional development and for technology improvement and the like. That project ended this year in June after 5 years. It was, we think it was very successful, and the foundation thinks it's very successful. One of the things we decided to do in the first year of the project at the end of 2009 was have a conference. And, or not the end, yeah, it was the end of 2009, have a small conference to bring all the participants together as well as other people from their schools to share the ideas that they had for doing project-based learning. And we called it the Schools of the Future Conference. And we had 300 people show up the first time. We were at the Sheraton Hotel, I think. And they gave presentations to one another and talked about what was working, what was not. The second year, we held it at the Hilton, and other schools had asked if they could attend. They'd heard about the project, and even though they weren't participating in it, they asked if they could attend the conference. And especially because we had Sir Kenneth Robinson as our keynote speaker. And that conference, we also had many Department of Education teachers and administrators that came. And so we ended up being at the Hilton, and we had almost 900 people show up. Then after that conference, Hillary Apana McKee, who was working for the DOE, approached me, and she and I had worked together back in the 90s when I was at DOE and later in a private business that both of us worked as consultants on. She said that they used to have this thing at DOE called the e-school conference, and they just really hadn't had the money to do it anymore, and would we consider perhaps collaborating on Schools of the Future. And we didn't put it together in time for the third round, but by the fourth annual Schools of the Future conference, it was co-sponsored by DOE and by Hawaii Association of Independent Schools. And it was funded as part of the Schools of the Future initiative by the Hawaii Community Foundation. And then, so the past two and the current one this year are co-sponsored by DOE and HAIS, and now also by the Hawaii Society for Technology and Education, which itself was started by a group of people who part of the Schools of the Future initiative and realized that Hawaii was the only state that didn't have an ISTE affiliate. So that brings us to 2014 and next week. And it looks like we're going to have about 1,300 people. About half, I would say 45% from Department of Education, about 45% from and then the other 10% is a combination of the Catholic schools, the charter schools, as well as about 100 and some people from the mainland U.S. and a few people from Korea and China even.
Wow. Is that a huge increase from last year, Phil?
No. So Ken Robinson's thing was about 900. The following year was about 1,000, and then about 1,100. Last year we had 1,300 also. So it's about the same number of people as we had last year. But last year it was almost 60% Hawaii Association of Independent Schools and 40% DOE. So this year, and that's also the case also with the presentations, we had we had almost no presenters from DOE, and almost all the presenters were from Schools of the Future schools. And then last year we had about a fourth of the schools were Department of Education presenting, and the other 75% were HAIS. But this year, 60% of the presenting sessions, the breakout sessions, 80-plus breakout sessions, are by DOE teachers or administrators.
It's amazing.
And, about 40% are from HAIS schools. So there's a big transition there. And I'll tell you a little story about that that was interesting. I serve on the Windward District Advisory Council for with Lee Albert's Windward District Community Advisory Council. And it has several people from the state-level administration are on it. And last year, one of the state-level people attended Schools in the Future conference. And at the first meeting afterwards, he said, man, I just blew my mind. I went thinking it was going to be all about technology, and it wasn't. It was mostly about, you know, curriculum, education, teaching styles. And he said, I went to some sessions that were taught by Department of Education people that were doing such amazing things. I have no idea. Why don't we know about this stuff? So they were hiding behind the walls on this. But at any rate, so this year, and we always have two or three times as many proposals for presentations as we have slots. And so it's really difficult for the planning committee to select who gets to present and who doesn't. We try to give a preference to new people so that we aren't having the same old people coming up to talk. But even with that, it's still really difficult. And so this year, it's really great, I think, to see that we have like almost 60% of the presentations coming from Department of Education, teachers and administrators.
That's fabulous.
I wonder why such a huge difference from last year. I mean, you would think maybe it would kind of even itself out the following year, like go 40-60 the other way or 50-50, but to go from 75% private school presenting to 60% public school presenting, it, such a huge difference from just a year ago.
Yeah. In part, it was the teachers just didn't know about the conference in time to get into the cycle of putting in proposals, because we actually announced the opening of the proposals in December and the deadline is February. And so it was very hard to get the word out within the Department of Education, because even if you send it to all the principals, they're so overwhelmed with emails and everything on all the things they're responsible for that it just doesn't get down to the teachers. But once we had like 1,000 public school teacher and administrator names in our database from previous conferences, and we could send the information directly to them, then they promoted it within their colleagues and really got the word out.
Yeah.
Neat. So what's happening at the Schools of the Future conference?
What's not happening?
Very broad question now.
Great program this year. Our two keynote speakers are Jane McGonigal, whose book is called The Reality is Broken, and she's a Stanford University professor who left teaching at Stanford and started a public charter school based entirely on gaming, and they teach every subject only with games, and then basically if they don't have a game to teach some subject matter, then she has the teachers, but she has the students and the help build a game to do it. So it's very project-based and game-based and the like, and it's, so she's the Thursday keynote speaker to kick off. And then Friday morning we have Dr. Milton Chen, who was the founding executive director of Edutopia, which is the site started by Steven Spielberg. And Steven Spielberg is, you know, the Star Wars guy, and he took a lot of his money and put together this free site called edutopia.org for teachers, primarily public school teachers, that has tons of free resources on multimedia and video and project-based learning, design-based learning, almost anything you can imagine in that sort of realm. And in particular, sharing what's working and what's not in public education. And Milton was the head of Edutopia for a long time. He's retired as the executive director, but remains a senior consultant with them, and is doing a lot of speaking. So he'll have the keynote on day two. And then at lunch on day one, on Thursday, we also have a panel discussion that will bring together Kathy Matayoshi from representing the public schools, and Tim Cottrell, who's head of school for Iolani School. And they're going to be talking about this public-private partnerships agreement or arrangement that has been working for several years between HAIS and the DOE. Programs such as UAO at Punahou, where public school students are allowed to attend at no cost the Punahou summer session, plus some special courses to help them improve in various ways. And then also there are public school teachers are allowed to attend Iolani and Punahou summer institutes. So that's a public-private partnership type arrangement. And we're trying to expand that to get more private schools that have resources. We know DOE's budget keeps getting cut again and again, and especially in the area of professional development for teachers. And so we're trying to share that. There's a panel discussion at lunch, a beautiful lunch. Last year it was good, and this year it'll be even better. So there'll be the superintendent and Tim Cottrell. Dr. Tim Cottrell will be discussing the cooperation between DOE and HAIS to make education in Hawaii better. So those are the three main programs. In addition, we have featured speakers. We have nine people that are invited who are recommended to us, actually. On your screen, you see Jennifer Ryan. She's a well-known speaker, in particular on gender issues among students, students who choose to be a female body, but choose to be male, vice versa, or transgender type stuff, and how we deal with those types of students and support them. So she's going to be speaking both days. Stephen Edwards is a consultant from Alexandria, Virginia, who's got a lot of experience in the area of one-on-one computing, laptops and the like, as well as other areas for student-based technology integration. We have several people from that are speaking in the area of architecture, how to design learning environments, Randall Fielding has helped design many, not only design new schools, but how to redesign existing learning environments to make them architecturally supportive of various environments. I'm not going to go through all of them. They're up there, but we have the founder of Asset School. He's now on the mainland, but he'll be here to talk about special education students. Gail Lovely, she's very well known in early education, has a website to help early education technology integration issues, and Laura McBain is from High Tech High. She's been a speaker almost every year at the conference. She's very popular because she really understands performance-based assessment and the ability to really help students get grades by performing rather than just taking tests. I'll stop there. We've got the list of 10 featured speakers is also added with enhanced by speakers from some of our vendors, like Terry Trevethian that you see there. She's sponsored by Audiovisual Corporation, but she's an excellent speaker on the use of multimedia in classrooms and the like. Kim Sachs, that you saw earlier up ahead on there, she's the head of school for Nueva School in California, which is a really totally different type of learning environment, primarily for Hispanic kids, but she's done really amazing work in project-based and design-based learning. So you've got 10 featured speakers and about 10 sponsor speakers. Okwa Lee's from Korea, by the way. She was educated in the United States, but became the person that the Korean government almost 20 years ago tapped to introduce the internet into Korean K-12 education. And she's got lots of war stories to tell about how difficult that was in a very old-fashioned education system, introducing the internet and e-books and the like. And then you've got probably 65 Hawaii teachers and administrators that are going to be presenting in the 80-plus breakout sessions. And there's 13 simultaneous sessions during each of the 3 breakout sessions each day. And each of the people that's presenting knows their stuff and has tested it and already developed it and wants to share it. And so there's a real large wealth of resources.
Hey, Phil, I have a question for you. And I also want to thank Mike for giving a shout out to our session. Mike put up our Connect with Local Educators virtually. But Phil, my question for you is, there seems like such a great lineup of speakers, and I'm so excited for Jane McGonigal and Milton Chan. I was wondering what your process is for finding these folks each year. How do you go about locating or choosing speakers to invite?
So, excellent question. We send out to everyone who attends after the session, we send an evaluation form. And on that evaluation form, one of the questions is, who would you like us to invite as future keynote speakers? And so most of the suggestions, like both Jane and Milton were suggested by people last year. It's often hard to get these people because they're often booked years in advance. And they're really expensive. Jane's price to speak for 2 hours is $30,000. And because she'd never been to Hawaii, she agreed to come for $25,000. So, but she's going to be here for, she's going to stay the whole day. And Milton Chen was about $15,000. He's been to Hawaii many times and loves it. So, some of the speakers that were suggested were like $50,000 or $60,000, like Daniel Pink. Many people had suggested Daniel Pink, and he's $60,000 for a one-hour talk. Ken Robinson was $20,000 for a one-hour talk. So part of it is what can we afford, and part of it is many of these people are booked for several years in advance, and so they're just not available. But if you have any suggested superstars, you can email me, or on that evaluation form, you can let me know. And because you and Linda are both librarians, I should have mentioned that the second day of the conference, there's a day-long workshop called Next Generation Librarians, and that sort of put together by Faith Ishikawa and her colleagues at Department of Education. And then on day one, Gail Lovely and Elizabeth Park have put together an early childhood learning playground that will run the whole day.
Oh, Phil, I didn't know about the early childhood playground. Can you talk just briefly about that really quickly?
Yep. So basically, we've turned over one room for the whole day to Gail Lovely and Elizabeth Park, and they have a series of lectures, or presentations, not lectures, and they also have invited various vendors to put software and hardware in the back of the room that is basically showing what's available for early childhood education on iPads and laptops. And I totally blanked on what the word for the iPhone without the phone is, the iTouch or something like that. So they'll have hardware, software demonstrations that you can play with, and then Gail and I think Okwa Lee also and Elizabeth Park will be presenting on research they've done in introducing technology to young children and appropriate use of technology and the like. So it's sort of like the librarian, Next Generation Librarians. It's an all-day event on Thursday.
I'm really glad to hear that. You know, some of my colleagues' perceptions in the past has been that they felt the sessions were geared more to upper elementary, middle, high school, and they didn't feel there were too many sessions for them. But, I mean, that's just their perceptions, you know. And I also know that there are people who go and they walked away still with really great ideas from previous schools of the future. But I think having this opportunity really focused on the youngest in our system will be a great thing. I'm really excited you folks are doing that.
Yeah, and that came as a result of, in the evaluations, numerous people had said, there's nothing for me, and I teach kindergarten or I teach preschool, and so do something in that area. Another area that we've started to look at and that we'll have sort of a track next year is arts integration. So many of the schools have had their art teacher or their music teacher got rid of them, or they were no longer hired so that they could have an athletic director or something like that, or a trainer or something. And so we're working with the Hawaii Arts Alliance to try to put together a track on arts integration, which is sort of how do you integrate the arts into teaching history and math and science and the like. But we get lots of good ideas from the evaluations, and we do try to follow up on them.
So it's a year-long process, right? You start on the next one right out on November 8th, probably.
Yep. We actually have a meeting, sort of a debrief. We've already set the dates for next year. It's November 3rd and 4th. And we've already got a list of possible keynotes that have been suggested to us, and we're in the process of contacting them. But we and then probably in December we'll open the website to accept proposals for doing presentations, and then and then by March we'll open registration again. So it is a year-long process. So
that's awesome. I wanted to thank Michael for scrolling up and down and around the website as we speak. That's really for the multitaskers, some extra little information. Thanks for doing that, Michael. I wanted to ask you, Phil, about the Edmodo piece, the way people can participate. And that seems to be a more prominent part of the conference. Could you tell us the Edmodo connection of how people can participate?
Yep. So this is the third year that we've partnered with Edmodo, and we have to thank Brett. I'm blanking.
Michael.
Tanaka. I'm sitting here drinking a glass of wine after work, so I slowly.
We thought that was juice. It's actually juice, everyone. It's a G-rated program.
So if I disintegrate slowly, you'll know why now.
You are sliding down a little bit, Phil.
But Brett Tanaka introduced us to Edmodo 2 years ago, and they provided sessions for us so that every single presentation has an Edmodo access point. And usually the speakers are, their presenters are invited to put up their slides and any other related materials. And anyone who's participating can continue a conversation with the presenter for 1 year after the conference. And so it really is a way for people to continue beyond just the 2 days of the conference with an ongoing conversation and sharing of resources around a topic that has been introduced at the conference.
Awesome. We have a question from Jody Brown. I guess she's in the background. Usually she comes up on the panel. And she's asking, how do you get funding for all the speakers? Does that come from the registration fee, or do you have?
A combination. So Jane McGonigal's fee is paid by the Hawaii Community Foundation. They agreed to pay for her. And Microsoft Corporation agreed to pay for Milton Chen. We do use registration fees to underwrite the cost of the featured speakers. So the 9 people who are presenting that we call featured speakers, their airfare and hotel and ground transportation and the like is paid for out of registration fees. We run this as a break-even operation, so there's no profit in it, and so we've got pretty low registration fees. The biggest cost is the food. Thanks to the Department of Education being a state agency, we get to use the convention center at half price. That's the second largest cost, is having 15 rooms there, plus all of the fourth floor ballroom. But the largest cost is close to $180,000 for food. And so the breakfast for 2 days, the lunches, especially the buffet lunch, is quite expensive, and then box lunches on the second day, coffee breaks 4 times. And then this year we have a closing reception on Friday. We're going to buy everybody a drink to celebrate the closing of a successful conference.
Nice. What about the, could I ask about the connectivity, which was pretty good last year, I thought.
Yes, and we have to thank Pacific Direct Connect for that. They have the contract with the convention center to provide internet services, and the cost to provide open internet service to anyone in the space is $50,000. And so we have over 2 days, and so we have 3 channels, a channel for the exhibitors, a channel for the presenters, and multiple channels to support all of the individual attendees, most of whom are bringing laptops and our iPads and our iPhones or Android phones. So it's a pretty tech-savvy group in general, and so there's lots of people working on it. But fortunately for us, we have 2 platinum sponsors. Pacific Direct Connect, thanks to Michael Browning, the owner, he's on the board of several schools and believes very much in what we're doing, and so he provides internet services to us for free. And it's worth $50,000. The other big sponsor is the audiovisual company, ABCO, and they provide all of the projectors and screens and sound systems in every room. And that also, the total value of that is about $46,000. So thanks to those 2 major sponsors, we have really excellent internet access and we have really excellent audiovisual support.
Megan Cummings is making a comment that she's going to be bringing 6 devices. I think she's going to need her own hotspot, Megan. That's funny. Very cool. Anybody else have questions of Phil?
No. Thanks, Phil, for sharing all that.
Yeah, it's quite amazing. And you are doing this year-round, and how many are in the on the committee?
So the planning committee is composed of Hilary Aponte McKee and Brett Tanaka from Department of Education, Mark Hines and myself from Hawaii Association of Independent Schools, Michael Travis is the current president of HISTE, Hawaii Society for Tech and Education, so he's representing HISTE. And Piakea Miller is a education program officer from the Hawaii Community Foundation. So that's the formal planning committee that meets once a month all year round, and then as we get closer, we meet twice a month. In addition, Hillary has 2 or 3 of her staff who provide support with registration during the year. And I have 2 people, one in finance and our accountant, Myrna Medeiros, and Aaron Terrell, who provide support to me for a lot of the day-to-day stuff. And I'm sort of the chairman of the chairman of the board, or whatever it's called, or the planning all year round.
Well, it seems very well organized, and I love that you have the variety, like Michelle mentioned, the early education, and then next year you'll be doing the arts. So it looks like you're very responsive to what people want, which is wonderful. And yeah, the fact that all the public schools are joining in is a coup. I think that is fabulous.
Yeah, we're very excited about that. And when you think how many teachers there are in Hawaii, it's close to 30,000 K-12 teachers in Hawaii in the public, private, charter, and Catholic schools. And Mike Travis asked one day, he says, why don't more teachers come to our event? We could have like 3,000 or 4,000. And I said, well, there's only so many substitute teachers that are available to replace them on any given day. So we're running out of substitutes. But, you know, we did have in the first couple of years some of the private schools just closed for the day, like Astatz and Hanalani and Mid-Pacific would just close their school for the day and bring everybody. This year we have two public schools that just closed. They're bringing their entire faculty for one day. So I think maybe in the future, if word gets out about that, the idea that since every school is allowed, I guess, professional development days, that perhaps they might just say, this is our professional development day and we're all going to schools of the future.
Mm. Which schools are that? Those, if you're okay to say? Which schools are getting off?
So the one I'm remembering is Waikiki Elementary, and I'm sorry I can't remember the second public school that's closing. Hanalani and Midpac are the two private schools that are closing and bringing all their faculty. And then there are many schools, like Kamehameha, all three campuses together are sending almost 100 teachers.
Wow.
And so it's not every school can afford to do that, but there are group discounts.
They send that many to ISTE as well.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think they had 55 or 60 people to ISTE this year.
You know, Phil, I'm just wondering if, is that information shared out? I mean, it's kind of a neat idea, like you were just saying, that the schools close and then it's a PD day for teachers to attend schools of the future. Even if a DOE school did that for one day, it would be, you know, a really great experience for the teachers. And then I really liked the data you shared earlier, too, about how over the years the number of public school teachers participating in this event has grown. And I'm just wondering if, is that put out to the principals or through the DOE in some way, that increasing participation?
So I didn't even know they could do that until this year. When it was when Waikiki Elementary approached us for a group discount for their entire faculty. We do have group discounts for 10 or more teachers from any one school, but so, I mean, I don't know how to get the word out. I guess I can leave it up to Hillary or Brett to, or we can announce it maybe at the at the conference, we can mention that what a great idea that is.
I'm kind of thinking it's good advertising for the conference itself. And I mean, I know that Mike and I, for instance, probably Linda too, we've spread the word at our schools. My colleagues and I presented 2 years ago, and then each year we've invited more of our teachers to present. So, you know, that's kind of neat. We're trying to build that capacity by inviting more of our teachers.
Yeah. Well, I do think as more people know about it and are on the mailing list, our list of previous attendees is about 2,300 now between public and private school teachers, so that we send information out. So that's for the most part, how as we get more information out into the grassroots level, it'll probably percolate up better than, like I said, when you send something to the schools, to the principal or to the SASA, they're just so overwhelmed with, and that's true of the private schools too, it's not just the public schools. So much information.
You might want to invite the press too.
We do?
The TV cameras. You do?
We invited both Civil Beat and the Star Advertiser. Civil Beat took us up on it. Thus far, the Star Advertiser is not.
Maybe tell the a TV station. About it. TV yeah. station.
Yeah. So we tell the TV stations about it, and they're likely to show up on the day and take some pictures and do a few interviews in case it's news, but that doesn't help with promoting it earlier in the year. And so it's sort of what's happening right this minute as opposed to the real time to think about it and plan for it, for the most part, we think is already in the spring as a school chooses its professional development days and looks at its professional development budget possibilities for the following year. So
I have a question.
Go ahead.
Have you ever thought of recording any of it or webinars, something for teachers in the Outer Islands?
That's a great question.
Yes. Yeah. So we do hire videographers. Last year we had two, and we taped 12 sessions. And we put them up on the HAIS website in streaming mode, and then the teleschool division of DOE taped both of the keynotes last year, and they'll be taping both of the keynotes this year, and that's available on a password-protected site in the Department of Education that they also are willing to share the password with anybody who attended the conference.
And well, then what I guess about you can, those of us who couldn't attend the conference?
Yeah, so I suppose that if you know somebody who went to the conference, then you can say, what's the password? I want to watch it. I sort of don't know what the rules are. Both keynote speakers this year said, we're fine with having it behind a password-protected site at Department of Education, and as many Hawaii educators who want to watch it is fine, but getting that word out, I suppose we probably should send it to all the librarians instead of all the principals.
That's right. Librarians are connected.
All the librarians are nodding furiously.
Mike Travis, who's actually supposed to be on the panel. How come you're not on the panel, Mike?
Mike, where are you at?
He is asking, not asking, he mentions that Asset School is also closing and bringing over 70 staff and teachers.
That's true. Over the 2 days, they're bringing their entire faculty and staff. So, and I should mention that in addition to the two-day conference, Mike Travis and his colleagues at HISTE put on the Hawaii Education Leadership Summit on Wednesday, which is a special, smaller event focused to the leadership teams in public and private schools. And they have about 50, 60, 70 people in teams of two or three, up to five, I think, that attend a all-day session with expert speakers coming in. And it always has a single theme, and then and it's not just listening to people talk, but they have roundtable sessions as part of it. And then that's the day before the conference, and then this year, the day after the conference, Michael, and several of his colleagues are putting on the second EdCamp event, which is sold out, so you can't go. But that event is an unconference format. Michael can tell you a lot more about that. So instead of having people like our planning committee decide what we think you want to listen to, you can show up at EdCamp and have a voice in what you want to listen to.
Yeah, I think, you know, by us strategically placing EdCamp after Schools of the Future provides an opportunity for those that attend to continue conversations and explore, continue to explore the things that interested them at the conference or ask questions of people that have greater knowledge of the topics that they're interested in. So should be a great EdCamp, too, to follow Schools of the Future.
Yep.
Hey, it will be a great EdCamp. And then, Mike and Linda, isn't it the Monday right after we're doing EdChat Hawaii is focusing on gaming, game-based learning, and gaming and education?
Yeah.
So it's a whole weekend of activities. And then, Linda, are you going to go to HASL's dinner on that Friday night after Schools of the Future, but before Ed?
I'm thinking about that, but I'm not sure I can handle that much professional development. I definitely want to be... There's Mike. Yay!
Hey, Mike.
Welcome.
Thanks. The link didn't work earlier, so I was got in the wrong way. Sorry.
Oh, no. No problem. You got in the wrong way. Okay. Welcome, Mike Travis. We have we're almost to the end of the hour, but go for it. You have anything to add? Have you been listening in, Mike?
I just came in about 20 minutes ago. Caught in traffic, so in town. From the planning meeting that Phil was at, I'm sure. So yeah, I had to pick up my daughter and stuff. So I don't know what everybody said so far, but yes.
He's told us all about how the conference started. How the planning committee chooses speakers, how much it costs, and how they get funding. He talked about the Edmodo piece. He talked about the early education day on Friday, and also I think it's on Friday, and also the librarian's day on Friday. Basically, and the development of the conference. So and then Michael's been doing the Vanna White thing, showing.
did he talk about the bookstore? Did you talk about the bookstore yet?
I was going to say, Mike, if you want to mention, if you want to talk a little bit about the Making It Happen Award.
Oh,
jumping on the bookstore.
Don't have my notes in front of me, but yes, the Making It Happen Award is actually an ISTE award. That's the International Society for Technology and Education, but each of the affiliates give the award away to people they feel are worthy of that. So a few months ago, you might have seen, if you're a HISTE member, an email going out asking for nominations. So we got lots of nominations for lots of qualified people. Basically, it's an award given to someone in thank you for putting that up, Michael, so that I don't have to read it. But yes, so that kind of gives you a description there that Michael just put up about what the award is all about. I was honored, and Jordan Higa, last year to win that award. That was a great honor, and I'm humbled to be a member of that group now, the Making It Happen group. And so we'll be giving out those awards on Friday morning before the keynote. So if you're there, you'll be there. If you're there on Friday, you'll be in the audience, and we'll give out those awards to those honorees. And I always remind people, even if you didn't win this year or weren't nominated, you know, start thinking about people to nominate for next year. Usually about three months ahead of time, we'll give that award. And the award winner will receive a jacket. That's the Making It Happen award jacket. And then a certificate. And then I believe they get we will be giving them coupon for a free ISTE conference registration this year. And they also get an ISTE free membership for a year as well. So it's a great honor, and it's great for the school that the person is working at as well. Any questions about the award? If not, I only have 2 minutes left, so I might mention the bookstore. Did you mention the bookstore?
We can go a few minutes over. Talk about the bookstore. I think that's so cool.
Yeah, so in the previous years, the bookstore was run by just a local company, but this year, HISTE volunteered to take charge of that. And so because of our affiliate with ISTE, the ISTE has lots of books that members have written, and all about education, educational technology, pedagogy, things like that. So we went through our, some of our board members went through and found some really great books, and we can get it at a substantial discount shipped to us. And then we put the price at a really reasonable price. It's cheaper than the cost of the book, and but the profits will go to HISTE, the nonprofit HISTE, to help create more great events for all of our members. And so there's just a lot of great books. In addition, we will have book signings for both the keynotes, Jane McGonigal and Milton Chen, and also two other featured speakers, Jennifer Bryant and the last one slipping my mind. But he'll pop it up for me, won't he? Yes, okay, Gail Lovely, who is doing the early childhood area. And so please come to the book signings. You can buy the book and then get it signed and meet the authors. So the two keynotes will be happening, the keynote book signings will happen right after their keynote. So after their keynote, we're going to try and rush Jane over to the bookstore, which is in the vendor area, and you can come purchase books there. We're going to accept cash, check, or charge. Let's see. Also, I don't know if we talked about the vendor area at all. I think I heard Phil talking a little bit about vendors, but one last minute thing I might just mention is we're going to have these sheets that you will get in your packet, and if you go to the vendors, each of them will have a special stamp, a picture, or a little animal or something. And if you go and visit 10 of the vendors and get 10 of them to stamp the sheet, you can turn it in at the HISTE bookstore area for free drawings that will happen on Friday at the end of the event. So, and if you can get 20 of the vendors, then there's a special box for that, and those prizes will be even better. So please, the vendors are supporting us in making sure that this conference is successful. They have a lot of great items showcasing that are great for educators. So please go to the vendor area and check it out. It's a lot bigger than it has been in previous years and will be really interesting and exciting. I think that's it. I'm over the time, so.
It's going to be busy.
Question, Mike and Foy, is Hell's registration closed, or can people still register?
Yes, it has closed this year. We had to officially close it to get the food counts. But thanks for asking. But there's always next year. We'll probably have this every year the day before the Schools of the Future. So, and yes.
Any questions, Michelle or Holly? I'm not sure Holly's still there. Or Michael? Any questions of Phil and Mike?
No.
I wanted to thank Phil and Mike for coming on. I'm kind of last minute. You probably noticed that, and you probably thought, it's a one-time thing, but I'm always last minute. And so I was really pleased that you had said, yeah, let's come on.
I wish I could have gotten here earlier. It sounds like Phil did an awesome job, so thank you, Phil.
He did. Yep. Really did. Well, and you too, Mike. Both.
Thank you for inviting us.
Yep.
If anyone has further questions, they can contact me directly, just straight through the HISTE site. It's just info@histe.org, and I check that email very frequently, so I can answer any questions you have as we get closer to the date.
Sounds good. Okay, so we are a little bit past the hour, and it was another full show. Next week we are having the famous to us, so Michelle knows who this is. It's Linda Yolis, who is a pretty prolific blogger. She has class blogs, and she's won some awards. And she's agreed to come on. She's out of California, and she's going to be talking about how our kids should be blogging. So cool. really looking forward to that as well. And thanks to Michelle, I have to say, we have some cool things happening in December as well. She's turning into the artistic director of Google Rocks Hawaii with all these neat ideas, which are formulating as we speak. So we are the beneficiaries of her go get a speaker for our show. So much appreciated, Michelle. I wanted to tell everybody about that. So we shall say aloha for tonight, and we'll see you next week. Thanks for watching.
Aloha. Thank you.
Great, aloha. Thank you.
Aloha.
Aloha.